I'm going to be talking about a pregnant patient with kidney disease. The talk will be in the form of some case winners and some approaches. I'll begin with a very well-known adage, which would say a man is what he eats. And adding on to that, a baby is what her mother eats or does not eat during her pregnancy. Well, the magnitude of the problem, as ma'am has rightly pointed out, is that up to 3 to 4% of women of childbearing age are affected by chronic kidney disease. And with the better management that is available to patients at this time in age, the pregnancy rates in CKD women have also risen over time. The major issues which plague these women are that they have a higher tendency of developing gestational hypertension and preeclampsia, conditions like polyhydramnios, IUGR, small for gestational age babies, as well as many more stillbirths than in the general population. Also, the risk of chronic kidney disease later in life is increased in children born to CKD mothers. This is because of the higher incidence of preterm births in this population. Also, in maternal GFR of less than 40 ml per minute, for a majority of chronic kidney disease cases, the mean GFR fall per month increases from a baseline of, let's say, around 0.2 to 0.3 ml per minute fall to almost up to 1 ml per minute per month fall when the patients get pregnant and in the post-pregnancy, as in postnatal phase. Therefore, it's an important problem to consider. So the goals of nutrition therapy in pregnant CKD include optimizing the fetal growth and development, because finally the result of a pregnancy is producing a healthy child. Also at the same time, ensuring adequate metabolic control for the mother and ensuring that her GFR does not fall too much, and as well as individual recommendations for certain important vitamin and mineral supplements, such as those of the bone mineral axis, as well as those affecting iron deficiency. So I'd like to begin with my first case scenario, which is that of Ms. P, who's a 26-year-old patient, a diagnosed case of IgA nephropathy with chronic kidney disease, was now presented at 12 weeks gestational age. Her baseline meds include amlodipine, calcium carbonate at about 1 gram, and folic acid. She already is receiving docosahexaenoic acid and icosapentaenoic acids, as well as omega-3 capsules. And her weight at this point in time is 52 kilos at 12 weeks gestational age, whereas her pre-gestational weight was about 50 kg, which means she's gained up to 2 kilos now. Height is 158. Her pre-gestational BMI is 20-21, and BP is 130 by 82, and there is no pedal edema. Her creatinine is 1.7. Pre-gestational used to be 1.89. So, you know, that kind of a fall is predictable because of some improvement in GFR during the first trimester. The hemoglobin is in the anemic range. Urine shows some bit of proteinuria, and serum albumin is 3.98. She asks you, as her treating nephrologist, for any changes in her diet plan at this time. So what do we think about the weight gain? Do we think that's okay? Yes, we think that is okay, because when we look at cumulative weight gains, they can range from up to 5 to 18 kgs. It is prescribed that patients who are obese should gain about 5 kgs, and those who are underweight can gain up to 18 kgs in pregnancy. Same holds true for up to CKD stage 1, 2, and also up to 3. And of this all weight gain, only up to 1 to 2 kgs of weight gain occurs in first trimester. So our patient who has gained about 2 kilos of weight in her first trimester is probably doing just okay. Higher weight gains have been recorded in patients who have been placed on medical nutrition therapy. Again, something that is probably not accessible to many women with CKD in our population. Now, what to do with protein restriction? This patient would have hitherto been on a 0.8 grams per kg diet. If she was not receiving ketoanalog, so possibly she was receiving a 0.8 grams per kg diet. So what do we do with the protein restriction? As far as the pregnancy guidelines go, and those which are extendable into the CKD 1 and 2, is that one can use 1.1 grams per kg per day protein diets in this population. This is, again, not very evidence-based. And the evidence to support a 0.8 grams per kg per day diet in such females with some additional protein, additional pregnancy needs, is another approach which is followed. This is borne out by some individual case series as well as case studies. Again, the evidence for this is not very high, but the additional protein needs, and probably in the first trimester of pregnancy, will just be about 1 to 3 grams of extra, and any more extra which is needed needed for proteinuria. Otherwise, it can still be in the 0.8 grams per kg per day range. with 50% of it being of high biological value. Again, there are groups which have suggested giving plant-based proteins in CKD pregnancies. They have been seen to be associated with better outcomes, such as the vegan vegetarian diets in which animal proteins are completely avoided. Dairies are given about once or twice in a week, and the rest of the days the patient receives mostly a vegan kind of protein diet. This is supposed to reduce the glomerular hyperfiltration and thereby contribute to less glomerulosclerosis in the long run. Also, especially so if it is combined with keto analogs, the fetus is not deprived of essential amino acids, and therefore such a diet is thought to be tenable too. So again, coming on to the role of keto analogs, people have looked into this, but the evidence for this is again not strong. It's again based on a majority of these studies have come from from Italy, where they have suggested a 0.6 to 0.8 grams per kg per day diet with as in moderate protein restriction with keto analogs at almost the same dose as we use in non-pregnant persons. And this has been seen to be associated with a paradoxical decrease in early preterm, very low birth weight, and small for gestational age infants. Note, this is for very low birth weight infants and not for the low birth weight infants, which is more or less a pretty common phenomenon with CKD pregnancies. Would there be any changes to the lipid prescriptions already given? Well, it is known that omega-3 fatty acids are related to retinal and neurological development. So consistent with existing guidelines, the intake that the patient is taking seems to be pretty good. But in the later trimesters, we need to watch out for whether this patient would develop any hypertriglyceridemia or hypercholesterolemia, according to which these supplements may need to be stopped. So what do we do to raise hemoglobin in anemic patients with CKD? In especially the early stages, oral iron may be prescribed up to almost 120 milligrams per day. And iron studies may be done more assiduously, especially as the stage of CKD increases. And prior to thinking of ESAs, especially in lower stages of CKD, probably iron profiles should definitely be done. Folate supplementation of 5 mg per day is definitely sufficient, also in patients who are undergoing dialysis. So any nutritional plans to prevent preeclampsia, because this is the kind of population in which we expect them to be at a very high risk for preeclampsia. So one of the things that can be done is to increase calcium intake, which in women with normal renal function, as well as with lower stage of CKD, has been seen to be associated with a lower risk of preeclampsia. Up to 1.5 to 2 grams per day has been prescribed. But again, in most stages of CKD, we do not plan to go beyond 1.5 grams per day. So at least that can be done. Vitamin D supplementation should also be carried on to maintain levels of more than 30 picograms per ml. Okay, so this lady now continues her pregnancy, and at 28 weeks gestational age, her serum creatinine is 1.8. We're pretty satisfied, while BP also remains controlled. But the urine has now started showing about 2 plus albuminuria, somewhat increase in RBCs as well. Serum albumin has dipped to a certain extent, and the 24-hour urine protein is up to 3.2 grams per day. Upon pregnancy monitoring, the fetus appears to be small for gestational age. Now, our concerned patient, in whom we did put her on a lower protein intake diet, asked whether she should increase her protein at this juncture. Well, the data on low protein diet, as I had already mentioned, is limited to only single centers, and people have used vegan vegetarian diets with alpha keto analogs, which were associated with a reduction in very low birth weight infants. But these studies were again not associated with much better preservation of GFR in pregnancy or in the perinatal period. Also, we must remember that the amount of proteinuria that is there, that also needs to be replaced from the maternal point of view, along with the pregnancy needs at this point in time. So now moving on to a second case. Now that we've covered some cases of a case of CKD at a lower stage, we go on to Ms. R, who's a G2P1 at 25 years of age. She had a stillbirth 2 years back when she was diagnosed with advanced chronic kidney disease, is now on maintenance hemodialysis for the last 20 months, with her basic disease being unknown and almost nil residual renal function, brachiocephalic AVF axis, and she has presented with amenorrhea. Again, she has a 12 weeks gestational age with single live fetus. She's on multiple medications, as we can see here. And her weight is 50 kilos, and her pre-gestational weight was just about a kilo less than that. And her BMI also does not seem to be in the underweight category. And her blood pressures are moderately raised. There's no pedal edema, and the hemoglobin is 10.4. Among other things, she now wishes to ask you regarding her diet plan. in this particular thing, the weight gain at the end of first trimester, again, we would say that in hemodialysis patients also, there is only up to a kg of weight gain in the first trimester. In the later trimesters, we expect, or we and at least according to the existing studies, up to 0.5 kg per week has been seen, especially those with receiving a good medical nutritional therapy. So the weight gain of 1 kg is thought to be acceptable. And the dry weight targets need to be titrated, because it might be possible that even before such a patient who is normally amenorrheic realizes that she is amenorrheic because of pregnancy, somebody may be trying to assiduously try to get her weight down to her dry weight. It may happen not at the extent of the nephrologist, but at the where the dialysis technician himself is concerned that, you know, her weight has increased, probably she is gaining more fluid. This is where we need to be very careful about dry weight titration in patients in first trimester of pregnancy and on dialysis. But any changes to the energy and protein recommendations? Elderly patients in any case would be having a higher resting energy expenditure, so they receive about 35 kilocalories per kg, and some additional pregnancy needs are also covered in this, in which 100 kilocalories are for the first trimester, and these increase up to 300, then to 500 in the later two trimesters. In peritoneal dialysis patients, the calorie requirements are lower at about 25 kilocalories per kg per day. This is primarily because of the dextrose that they receive and the additional pregnancy needs as required. As far as protein requirements are concerned, from 1.1 to 1.3 grams per kg per day using the ideal or current dry weight have been used. And further, as the intensiveness of the HD increases to more than, there are centers which use just more than 20 hours per week, to centers which use even more intensive therapies than that. With that, the protein intake has to increase a lot. It may be possible that patients might become hypoalbuminemic during such intensive hemodialysis courses. So when they're unable to consume high protein diets and they're showing consistently low serum albumin levels, it may be necessary to give them intradialytic parenteral nutrition in the form of amino acids to improve. And this has been seen to improve pregnancy outcomes in such patients. What are the acceptable fluid gains in interdialytic period? Again, this is extrapolated from the non-pregnant population, in that in any case, we are trying to tackle the fluid gain by increasing the frequency of dialysis. So keeping the gains up to 4 to 5% of dry weight and to balance necessary fluid intakes as a normal pregnancy should be enough. Now I'm moving on to to my last case scenario, which is that of Miss T, who's a 32-year-old kidney transplant recipient. She is 34 months since her transplant. Her basic disease was congenital anomaly of the kidney and urinary tract. She's on tacrolimus, azathioprine, and steroid for the last 9 months, ever since she started considering to get pregnant. With a stable graft function at this point in time, she presents at 24 weeks of gestational age with a weight gain of 11 kgs, and she has also developed gestational diabetes mellitus. Her pre-gestational BMI was 21 kg per meter square. There's no evidence of preeclampsia at this point. Apart from that, her medical history in the post-transplant phase has been significant for persistent hyperparathyroidism and hypophosphatemia, for which the patient had to be put in cinacalcet, which was stopped again at the time when she conceived. And serum calcium levels in this patient remain normal. So there are two specific questions that can come up here as to what would be the dietary plan for gestational diabetes mellitus in this kidney transplant recipient, and what is the dietary plan to tackle the hypophosphatemia. Well, GDM in postrenal transplant is attributed to diabetogenic factors such as the use of CNIs and steroids. In some cases, it has also been linked to a longer longer dialysis vintage prior to having received a transplant. And again, specialized medical nutrition therapies advised for gestational diabetes mellitus to maintain nutritional adequacy and also prevent ketosis and prevent outcomes such as macrosomia and other fetal problems. Up to 30 kilocalories per kg per day, recommendations are made, of which 30 to 40% of which should be complex carbohydrates. Up to 35 to 40% should be fat, 20% should be proteins, and at least a minimum of 28 grams of fiber is suggested. I would not delve much deeper into GDM because that's again out of the way for nephrologists. Well, management of hypophosphatemia and pregnancy, it's pretty much unknown because most of what we see is maintaining phosphorus in patients of dialysis who are undergoing, who are pregnant. In them, we just stop phosphate binders and we do not really worry much in terms of what next to do about phosphorus. But what about post-renal transplant patients who are hypophosphatemic, which is a very major segment of at least Indian transplant patients? very high numbers of them are hypophosphatemic. There are several approaches. People have used high phosphorus diets. People have used giving phosphorus supplements, but these are limited by the development of diarrhea, hypokalemia, and other issues. This is a major problem in these patients. There are, in fact, case reports which are available which describe the development of hemolysis and other issues in patients who are pregnant with hypophosphatemia. And there are centers which have used cinacalcet, ongoing cinacalcet, because it's while the patient is still pregnant, to avoid a severe hypophosphatemia in this population. Well, as far as recommendations in these patients go for pregnant CKDs, there are practically no recommendations available. Whatever recommendations there are combined from those which are being given for CKD and those which have been given for pregnancy. So there's an urgent need for developing recommendations in this population. But this is just to summarize what I had been presenting in the earlier few slides, that in cases of stages, earlier stages of CKD, up to 25 kilocals per kg per day of energy should be fine. In stage 5 dialysis, energy intakes should be more, up to 35 kilocals per kg per day. For PD, it could be up to 25. And pregnancy energy needs to be added to the other prescription of energy that we are giving for these patients, which I have outlined as in first, second, and third trimesters respectively. Suggested weight gain is 5 to 12 kgs as for non-renal failure patients. Protein recommendations, again, for CKD 1 and 2, we can go with the usual 0.8 grams per kg per day. And for CKD stage 3 and 4, lower can be tried, especially so if we are planning for keto acid supplementation. And we need to supplement the additional pregnancy needs as have been outlined over here, with very low requirements in the initial trimester and increasing towards the later trimesters. Right. And for hemodialysis, higher protein requirements are necessary, as well as for peritoneal dialysis. In fact, there have been centers which have used almost as much as 1.8 to 2 grams per kg per day in patients who are showing small for gestational weight infants, fetuses, and they have given even intradialytic amino acids for the better growth of the fetus. Lipid recommendations have again been pointed out, that the total fat recommendation pregnancy is less than 30 to 35% of total energy, which is similar to the non-CKD pregnancies. And the others are that the cholesterol intake should be kept less than 200 to 300 milligrams per day. Carbohydrate recommendations are also similar to the patients of non-renal failure patients. And the acceptable carbohydrate intake is up to 45 to 65% of total energy intake. And the fiber intake has to be optimized. And the minimal carbohydrate intake, which has been suggested, is up to at least 175 grams per day. Fluids, again, individualized in the later stages of CKD, especially those who are in dialysis, at least we can tend to be more liberal with the fluid intake, because they're going to have fluid removal pretty much with all the intensive dialysis that they're getting. And calcium, as I said, we need to keep it below 2 grams and from 1.5 to 2 should be optimal for such patients. Phosphorus restriction may not be necessary. The phosphorus intake should be at least 550 to 700 milligrams. Again, we need to be careful if the patient is also having concomitant hyperemesis gravidarum. It may be possible that even early stages CKD might develop some degree of hypophosphatemia. We need to be careful about that. And vitamin D supplementations have also been thought to be necessary. Iron, HB needs to be kept more than 11 grams per deciliter. Oral and IV supplements may be necessary, and ESA use may also be necessary, and we need to maintain a TSAT of more than 20 and ferritin more than 100. Folate needs can be higher, especially so in dialysis patients. And sodium up to 3 to 4 grams per day, and even 3 gram potassium diets have been given in pregnant hemodialysis patients who are receiving at least about 24 hours of hemodialysis a week, with good positive perinatal outcomes being reported in this class. This is the end of my presentation. The take-home messages are that pregnant CKD women are at a high risk of pregnancy complications, as well as renal disease progression and of IUGR and SGA babies. As no specific recommendations exist, we need to really adapt the recommendations that are already available. The roles of the renal nutritionist and the nephrologist lie in optimizing these intakes to promote maternal and fetal health, as well as metabolic control. With these adaptations, very low birth weight deliveries and negative outcomes may largely be avoided. Thank you.